Well, a friend of mine named Steve Goodman wrote that song, and he told me it was the perfect country and western song. I wrote him back a letter and I told him it was not the perfect country and western song because he hadn't said anything at all about mama, or trains, or trucks, or prison, or getting drunk. Well, he sat down and wrote another verse to the song and he sent it to me, and after reading it, I realized that my friend had written the perfect country and western song, and I felt obliged to include it on this album. The last verse goes like this here. Well, I was drunk the day my mom got out of prison, and I went to pick her up in the rain. But before I could get to the station in the pickup truck, she got run over by a damned old train.
So that song clip that started us out there is a little bit funny, isn't it? Funny because it calls attention to the fact that there are a lot of cliches that we tend to think of when we think of country music. And, you know, cliche is not a bad word. You know, a lot of times a cliche becomes a cliche because there's some sense of truth or effectiveness about it. And, you know, when we're hearing that David Allan Coe song where he talks about all the cliches that need to be put into a country song, that sort of sets the stage for us to talk about the history of country music and how these cliches that we use sometimes to make fun of country music are actually very true things that sort of help define the genre and make it go. Now, there's this slide that's up here right now, and there's nothing wrong with your screen. It's a very messy-looking slide. Some of the words are in white print. Some of the words are in black print. They're all overlapping. And what it is it's actually something we did in class a couple years ago when I was teaching this class live, and I just told everybody, tell me the first words that come in your mind when you think about country music. What is country music about? And this was the list I made, and I've got all the words here, so it's a little confusing, but let me break this down and you can see it a little bit more clearly. I'll show you one slide that shows you all of the words that are in black print and one slide that shows you all of the words that are in white print. You look at these words that are in white, or that are in black print, excuse me, and they're things like, you know, lion, revenge, guns, cheating, prison. They're things that sort of could have a negative connotation to them, or, you know, that could be things that, like, you know, talk about people's propensity toward bad behavior or something like that. And then you look at all the words that are in white print, and these are all terms that are more positive. You know, mama is certainly a positive figure in most country song, as is the idea of a dog or going to church or working hard on a farm or whatever. So, you know, those two slides we've looked at here with the black print and the white print sort of show us the two different sides that we think of when we think of country music. We have the words that appear in white print that are sort of, for want of a better term, positive values, you know, things like, you know, working on a farm, valuing your family, valuing your church life, or, you know, the value of hard work and things like that. And then we have the words that are in black that are more things about, you know, potential misbehaviors like drinking too much whiskey or cheating on your wife or your significant others or committing murder or something like that. And when we put these conflicting terms together, they sort of make up two different poles of country music, because when you get right down to it, country music is sort of a bipolar type of music when you think about it. There are a lot of songs about the value of, you know, hard work and family relationships and, you know, being an honorable person. All the songs about Diddy was a hard-working man who loved mama and worked on the farm and got up early every morning with his dog and his truck and stuff like that. But then there are also all those terms in black that are sort of the more questionable things that we often hear visited in country songs. The idea about going out to the honky-tonk or the juke joint and getting in a fight and drinking too much and maybe cheating with somebody or something like that. And these two sort of different impulses of country music, the family values side and the hell-raising side, are things that have been with country music really since it began as a genre way back in the 1920s when people first started to record it and sell those recordings and things like that. Country has always sort of tried to like find a balance between home and hearth and hell-raising. And that's part of what makes it an interesting style, is that it's got both of those things going on at once. Wanting to be, you know, an upright citizen and a good family member, but also wanting to have a little fun on Saturday night, and maybe you'll get sent to prison for murder or something like that. It's part of the contradiction that makes country music go. And you know, the contradictions go a few different ways. You know, country music also has a contradiction not just between wholesome values and, you know, let it all hang out, blow off steam, questionable values, but it also has always had sort of a you know, push and pull relationship with technology. You know, in country music, the struggle between, you know, honoring tradition and the old ways and embracing technology and innovation has been something that's been reflected in the music and in the way people who perform country music have approached things as well. And if we go back to the very early days, when we start looking at, you know, the foundations of modern country music, we'll see that these things are already going to be in place. Hey, look, it's our map again. And I've got our map again because we need to get a little bit of geographic point of reference to know what we're talking about. When we're going to talk about sort of the formation of modern country music, we need to look again, not to big cities, but we're going to look at rural places. We're going to look at the city of Bristol, Tennessee, which is right up there on the Tennessee-Virginia border. Y'all can see it in red. Hopefully it's more or less in the right place. But it's an important place in the history of country music because in 1927, there's this man named Ralph Peer. And Ralph Peer is a man who works for a record company, goes out and records country music, which they called hillbilly music at this time, but he'd go and look for where you'd find this hillbilly music. He'd go look in rural places, find acts who performed it, record it, and they would press it onto records and sell it. And in 1927, he goes to Bristol, Tennessee, and has what have come to be known as the Bristol Sessions, where he records a lot of different country music artists from that Virginia, Tennessee, North Carolina, sort of Appalachian Mountains region. And from these sessions, we're going to find two very influential early country music acts that emerge. So Ralph Peer, it's not the last time I'm going to mention somebody who runs a record company, but Ralph Peer is out there gathering music that he can then take back, turn into records and sell for a profit. So he puts out a call for musicians and they come by his place in Bristol, Tennessee, where he's headquartered, and record for him so that he can have some authentic, what we now call country music, what he would have called at the time hillbilly music. And one of those groups that shows up is a group that very, very handily represents all those terms about country music that appeared in white print, all of the wholesome down-home country music values. That group is the Carter family. They come from rural Virginia, and there are three members of the group. There's Maybelle Carter, who plays the guitar. She's the one standing on the left side in that picture on the bottom center. A.P. Carter, who's the man seated in the middle, and his wife, Sarah Carter. She's pictured holding an instrument that's called an auto harp. Sometimes she played the auto harp, sometimes she played the guitar, and all three of them sang. But they showed up to Ralph Peer's call for musicians, and they recorded some songs for him, which he was able to market and sell, and which become, you know, representative of this idea of the down home on the farm, wholesome ma and pa country music values. And I'm going to listen to one of those songs now, and we'll talk about what we're hearing. So the song I want us to listen to is a song called Wildwood Flower. It's a song that the Carter family recorded actually a little bit later than the Bristol Sessions. They recorded it at a later session with Ralph Peer in 1928, although they were discovered in that initial 1927 session in Bristol. But Wildwood Flower is an interesting song. It's not a song the members of the Carter family wrote. It's actually a song that they may have come to know from sheet music, or that they may have known from just hearing it sung and passed down over time. But originally, Wildwood Flower was a parlor song from the early part of the 1800s, a song that went by the name of I'll Twine with the Mingles. And as a parlor song, its structure reflects how parlor songs go. Remember thinking back to our earliest unit in this class where we talked about how a parlor song is a strophic song where you have the same music, but the words are changing, and you don't have a chorus or a refrain or anything like that. So that's the structure of the song that they've inherited. But their performance style is very different than how a parlor song would have been performed in the 1800s, where it would have been performed probably in the parlor in a house with piano and with a singer trying to sing in that bel canto style. Now, the performance style they're going to apply to it, though, is a much more folksy performance style. The vocal style is very, very natural, very sort of twangy and country sounding and stuff, like that early recording I played y'all of Old Joe Clark on like the first or second class session we had together. And the instrumentation also is closer to what we'd find in folk music. Rather than, you know, bringing a piano or anything, they're playing it with guitars. And the guitar playing in this song is actually something that's worth noting. And here I am doing another guitar demo, because Wildwood Flower features a technique that becomes very important in country music and folk music. So Maybelle Carter there is actually one of our first guitar heroes, just like Robert Johnson was in the blues, because she introduces the thumb brush technique, which is a way where a guitar player can play the melody with her thumb. And brush the upper strings with her fingers to fill in the chords, so one guitar player can play the melody and the accompaniment at the same time. It's a nifty technique that a lot of guitarists pick up and adapt, because they realize they can make a very full sound by doing it. And some of them realize when they're making videos for their classes that they maybe should have learned the thumb brush technique when they were growing up, but I didn't. But that's me faking it, and I'm going to play the song for y'all now, and you can hear Maybelle doing it for real. Thank you. So that's the Carter family's recording of Wildwood Flower. And like I say, it was a successful recording in its time. Ralph Peer was able to market it as hillbilly music, which is what they called country music. They tended to have these, what we would think of as pejorative labels for music for marketing purposes at the time. They called country music hillbilly music. They called blues music and music by black artists, they've marketed it as race music. But so when we talk about race music, or when you hear that referenced in the early 20th century, they're talking really about blues music. When people talk about hillbilly music, they're talking about the earliest country music. But when we're listening to the Carter family, we get to hear some things there that are going to be important in country music. One is that that performance style is very folksy and natural and unaffected. It's a very twangy voice that Sarah sings Wildwood Flower in. There's that thumb brush guitar style that's important. And of course, you know, and these pictures just bear it out as well. The Carter family really did represent to many people that very wholesome, just good, plain folks image that a lot of country artists to this very day still try to make their public image. I'm going to play another Carter family song. It was actually their theme song. They, in addition to selling records, they had a radio show that was nationally syndicated. I believe it was broadcast out of Charlotte, North Carolina, but a lot of people learned their music from hearing them on the radio and things like that in the 1930s and 40s. So I'm going to play for you. This was their theme song, a song called Keep on the Sunny Side. And this one actually has all three members of the group singing. And if you listen real carefully in the background, I think you can also hear not just Maybelle playing her thumb brush guitar style, but you can hear Sarah playing the auto harp as well. So here's Keep on the Sunny Side.
Dark and the troubled side of life, there's a bright and a sunny side too. So we meet with the darkness and strife, this sunny side we also may view. Keep on the sunny side, always on the sunny side. Keep on the sunny side of life. It will help us every day, it will brighten all the way if we keep on the sunny side of life.
Okay, so there you get to hear the Carter family as a trio performing, like I say, what was one of their more famous signature songs. And we have in the Carter family our embodiment of the wholesome side of country music. Now let's look at another fellow who sort of shows us that other side of country music, the more rowdy side of country music. That would be this guy, Jimmy Rogers, a guy who also was discovered during the Bristol Sessions by Ralph Peer in 1927. He had gone up with a band and was going to record for Ralph Peer as well, and then the band dissolved the day before the recording session and didn't show up, so he showed up by himself and recorded some songs for Ralph Peer. And Jimmy Rogers also launched his career through doing that, a career where he was known as the singing brakeman. A brakeman was a person who would work on a train. His job was obviously to make sure that the brakes were functioning and to stop the train from rolling. And Jimmy Rogers, you know, often, you know, appeared in train worker garb, like you see in that picture on the lower left corner there, to sort of, you know, shore up that image as the singing brakeman. But his image also was that of the fellow who traveled about and didn't really have a home and just sort of, you know, lived a carefree life of a wanderer. And it's from him really that we sort of start getting this image of the country musician as the rowdy figure and stuff like that. So I want to listen to a song by Jimmy Rogers because it also shows us some of the influences he brought to country music that are rather different than the ones that the Carter family brought. So I want to look at a song called Blue Yodel Number 5. And there's a reason why they're all numbered. There are several different blue yodels by Jimmy Rogers out there. There are at least 11 or 12 of them, and I think there are more than that. But a lot of his recordings are under this title of Blue Yodel Number 5. And of course, you know, that word yodel showing up makes us think of something that, you know, when we think of yodeling, if it's going to show up in any type of popular music, it's probably going to be country music. And it's a very distinct effect that we think about as only being the province of country music if it's going to happen. But, you know, the first word is also important, blue, because, you know, blue is referring to the influence of the blues on his music. Jimmy Rogers' music has a fair amount of bluesy influence, and we find it a lot of times because he writes in 12-bar blues form. A lot of these blue yodels are done in 12-bar blues form, and that's certainly the case with Blue Yodel Number 5 here. Now, the way he performs is different than the way Robert Johnson or any of the other blues musicians we looked at perform, though. Jimmy Rogers is not a blues musician. He's a country musician. That's important. And when you hear him sing, you'll notice his vocal style is much more the sort of craggy nasal vocal style we associate with hillbilly music. But he does have some bluesy vocal inflections that sound like they're borrowed from blues music. His way of presenting his songs is sort of like how Delta blues would work. It's just him accompanying himself on the guitar. And the way he arranges his lyrics is very bluesy as well. I've got two verses of Blue Yodel 5 up there, and you'll notice that they're in that AAB couplet form that we find like Robert Johnson's blues songs being written in, or even like T-Bone Walker's urban blues song that we looked at. So there's a fair amount of blues influence going on in Jimmy Rogers, but with a more country vocal style and with, Lord help us all, the yodeling. So let's listen to the first few verses of Blue Yodel Number 5. So here's Blue Yodel Number 5.
Yodel-day-day-day-day, it's raining, yeah, storming on the deep blue sea. Lord, it's raining, yeah, storming on the deep blue sea. Ain't no black-headed mama can make a fool out of me. Oh, lady, lady, oh, lady. Now I can see a train coming down the railroad track. I see that train coming down the railroad track. And I love to hear the bark of that old smokestack. Yodel-a-dee, lady, lady, lady.
So, something that we could visit here is a term that I dropped a while back, which was that term cross-pollination. That idea about the thing that results when different musical styles combine to form something new. And, you know, we talked about it in reference to ragtime music, where we talked about how the syncopation of African music was being joined to the march form, which is more of a European art music type influence, that multi-part form that John Philip Sousa and people wrote in. But when we look at country music, we can also see that there's some cross-pollination going on here, especially in Jimmy Rogers, but also with the Carter family a bit. You know, and the cross-pollination in this sense is just about how all the three influences of American popular music feed into country music, because those three influences are European classical music, folk music, and African music. And if you think about where does European art music figure into this, well, you know, one way that we can see with the Carter family is that when they perform Wildwood Flower, it's important to remember that that was initially a parlor song. And parlor songs were modeled quite consciously on European art music like the aria and the lead. So we have European art music sort of getting its foot in the camp here a little bit because of the Carter family choosing to take a parlor song and perform it as an example of early country music. The British Isles folk music thing shows up in Jimmy Rogers and in the Carter family both in that performance style. You hear these people singing, and you can tell from their accents and their vocal styles, these are clearly country musicians. That sounds like the voice that one would expect to hear in an early country song. And African music is even managing to get its foot in the door when somebody like Jimmy Rogers is doing these blue yodels. And you can see real clearly the influence of the blues in some of the vocal inflections he does with the bent notes and stuff, but also with the fact that he's writing in the 12-bar blues style, or in a style that at least owes a lot to the 12-bar blues style. He plays a little bit freely with it sometimes, but you know, he's writing in the 12-bar blues, and it's clear from the way he's doing his lyrics in that AAB form that, you know, he knows what the blues is, and he's seeing that as a viable type of music to emulate and incorporate in his own original music. So we have this view of country music as being a cross-pollinated musical style, which is the case with most popular musical styles. They all are sort of the combination of a few different musical styles that get together and form this new style. And when we look at this other type of country music I want to look at in a second, we're going to see how country music is even going to cross-pollinate more by breeding in with technology as it existed in the 1930s and 40s, and by also joining up with what was really the main popular music style of the 30s and 40s, big band swing music. So let's look at what this is about. There's this style of music referred to as Western swing, which becomes sort of a thing in the 1930s and 40s. And it's, you know, it's an interesting way in which country music manages to intersect with the big band style, almost, in a sense. This is a picture of Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys. I'm going to play a tune by them in a minute, too. But if you look at how they're posed here, this is an interesting photo because there are several people there. You can see that all those guys standing in front of the bus, they were members of the band. So this is going to be a big band. It's not just going to be somebody with a guitar and an auto harp like the Carter family, but there are a lot of guys there. And there are a lot of guys there because this band is going to include a rhythm section of drums, bass, piano, guitar, but it's also going to include other instruments. In this case, fiddles, and sometimes there will be horns or trumpets available, which things we'd think about hearing in a swing band. And the other instrument we're going to hear in this is a steel guitar, because the song I'm going to play for y'all is a song called Steel Guitar Rag. And the steel guitar is an instrument that belongs most comfortably in country music. In fact, the instrument they use now these days is what's called a pedal steel guitar. And it's a guitar that the initial steel guitars, a player would hold it in his lap and play it with a big metal slide, like a bottleneck guitar or something. The pedal steel guitar is on a stand, and the player sits behind it, and it's horizontal, and the player plays it more holding his hands like a piano player holds their hands than like a guitar player holds his or her hands. But the steel guitar, it would be an amplified instrument, so there's this instance of technology being part of the Western swing sound here. And there's also this influence of swing music. These people played music that audiences danced to, and they had bands where there were instruments that were featured as soloists. So let's listen to The Steel Guitar Rag by Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys, featuring a guy named Leon McAuliffe on the steel guitar. Okay, so here we go. Steel Guitar Rag, and it starts out with the steel guitar at the very beginning.
All right, friends, here's that boy with his steel guitar. Take it away, my man. Take it away. Talk on. Yeah.
this piano solo is really more of a jazzy thing, isn't it?
The little man with the mustache.
Fiddle solo, rather country.
So
trumpet solo, very jazzy.
All right! That's Mr. Bashir.
Jazzier.
Is everybody having a good time? Of course you are.
So you hear something like that, and you can see how ideas of what we think country music is, most notably that steel guitar in that particular recording, are sort of going to, you know, combine with ideas of other musics. In this case, big band swings, where you have like that drum solo and that jazzy trumpet solo and the piano solo. And of course, you have them playing dance music like a swing band would have been playing back then. But They clearly are trying to promote themselves in a more country way. You know, you look at that picture and compare it to the pictures we saw of Duke Ellington and his orchestra, or the Glenn Miller Orchestra, and neither one of those groups felt the need to have a couple cowboys on horses in their publicity photos. But Bob Wills does. And, you know, that sort of brings up, you know, a good question anyway, which is, you know, what's the deal with cowboys in country music? You know, why are cowboy things such a big thing in country music? It's a good question. I'll try to give you a so-so answer for it. So once again, I get to bring back our buddy the map, which is, I mean, it's kind of interesting to have a map anyway to sort of see how things work, because for so much of the 19th century, when we're talking about the rise of songs and music publishing, we were really focused on urban places like New York City. But then, you know, ragtime and jazz sort of move our focus away and more toward, you know, the Mississippi River and the South and things like that. And when we talk about the blues, which is the area that's in blue on the map now, you know, the Mississippi Delta where the blues arises, you see, it's very much a region of the American South. And if we're talking about the origins of country music, which is this little yellow blob, then you can see that, you know, country music also originates from an area of the South that's rather rural and stuff. Now, don't take these diagrams to be incredibly accurate or to scale either, but I just like how, you know, when you look at it, you realize that when you look at where blues and country music come from, you realize they're rural developments and their southern developments. And country music spreads west throughout the 1930s, which is sort of what that gray area is showing, because a lot of people who listened to country music and played country music moved west in the 1930s, in part because of the Great Depression and things like that. If you think about a novel like The Grapes of Wrath and the story of the Joad family moving away from Oklahoma and out to California to try to find opportunity and to try to escape the Dust Bowl and stuff, then, you know, that family is not very different from a lot of the families that would have been consumers of country music or hillbilly music who went west to California looking for better opportunities and better work. And when they went, they took their music with them. just like when we're looking at the 19th century, we're talking about the story of Europeans who came over and brought their classical music or their folk music with them, or Africans who were enslaved and when they were brought over, brought their ideas of what musical practice was with them as well. So, you know, one reason why country music gets this sort of Western fetish and why a lot of people actually call it country and Western music is because it does move through the American West. And, you know, what's in the American West? Cowboys and our ideas of, you know, Western culture and stuff. And cowboys were a big deal in the 1930s and 40s. So in addition to the fact that country music sort of migrates through the West and through cowboy country, there's also the fact that, you know, a lot of times if people were going to movies in the 1930s, and that was a popular source of entertainment, a lot of what they might be watching would be Westerns, movies that featured cowboys, and featured cowboys in a very unambiguous way, in a way where cowboys were always the heroes. They were always, you know, going to win. The good guys in the white hats would come through and defeat the bad guys and make the country safe for civilization and schools and families and churches and things like that. You know, an old school Western is really sort of a thing that tells the story of the myth of building America and things like that. And in the 1930s, especially, that myth is very strong. The idea that there are these heroic cowboy figures. And a lot of times these heroic cowboy figures in movies even would, you know, sing songs and things like that. I'm thinking about cowboys like Gene Autry or Roy Rogers, to come up with a couple names that might be familiar. In fact, some people called some of these Westerns horse operas because they would feature a singing cowboy. But that's sort of where the idea of the cowboy really takes root in country music, is the cowboys are these sort of, you know, badass, get-her-done type guys who are out there fighting for fairness and justice, and they're very heroic. And that's why even today, if you look at country music stars, a lot of male country music stars are still running around sporting the cowboy hat and stuff. It's become part of country music, but it sort of worked its way into it because of what was popular in all of American entertainment culture at the time, and also because of the fact that we're dealing at a time when in the U.S. people aren't very questioning of cowboys or about, you know, is there a downside to going and settling the West and driving the native people off their land and things like that. It was all much more one-sided, all much more about, yeah, cowboys good. They defeat the bad guys. They defeat the guys who want to rustle cattle. They shoot the bad men with their guns. They're heroes in this time. And country music sort of fashions its early stars to be heroes. And a lot of country music stars we'll look at are going to be carrying along these Western aspects in their music. Case in point, the guy we're going to look at right now. This is Hank Williams Sr., perhaps the first real superstar of country music, and a fellow who cast a very, very long shadow over country music history, and sort of sets the tone for what a country musician is in a lot of ways, and a fellow who is very revered, almost to the point of, you know, having a mythic persona. And if you look at the pictures I've sort of chosen to put here, you'll notice that two different Hank Williams albums show up, both of them called Greatest Hits Collections. One has 20 songs, one has 24. But the things that's interesting about both of those albums, if you look at how they represent Hank Williams, he's represented as this sculpted bust of a figure, like you might find sitting in the U.S. Capitol. You might find a bust of George Washington or some very important politician. Or if you go to ancient Rome and look at how they presented, you know, Roman leaders like Cicero and Caesar and things like that, they're often presented in these sculpted busts. So here we have Hank Williams sort of being, you know, presented in these pictures as an immortal of country music. And you look at what's on his head in all these pictures, and darn it, there's not a cowboy hat on that guy. So he's one of these guys who works that Western image. Now the picture on the lower right-hand corner here, it's a picture of Hank and his band. And you can see that his band has a lot of instruments we would associate with country music. He's got himself playing guitar. He's got another guy on guitar down there in the lower right of the picture, there's a bass player on the left side. It's a fiddle player kneeling next to the guitar player. And that guy standing on Hank's left, that thing he's standing behind that's on a stand, that is a pedal steel guitar. And we're going to hear pedal steel guitar in this Hank Williams Sr. song I'm about to show you. When we talked about George Gershwin and Cole Porter and Duke Ellington and people like that, I talked about the songs they wrote and said that they were part of the imaginary Great American Songbook. If the Great American Songbook has a chapter on country music in it, and it certainly should, that's where you're going to find a lot of Hank Williams Sr.'s songs, because a lot of the songs he wrote became country music standards, songs that all the country musicians are familiar with and play and study to learn how the craft of country music is done. And I'm going to look at probably one of Hank Sr.'s most famous songs, Your Cheatin' Heart, recorded in 1952. So recorded, you know, back when Hank Williams would have been, you know, what, 29 years old? And he had a very short life. But when we hear this song, we're going to hear a lot of things that sound very country to us, especially in terms of the vocal style he sings in. You're going to hear the fiddle. You're going to hear the pedal steel guitar. But the other things to notice are that there are obviously other musical styles that have influenced him, such as Tin Pan Alley songs. Your Cheatin' Heart is written in an AABA form, just like we might find a Gershwin song or a Duke Ellington song being written. But when you hear the performance style, the vocal style sounds very twangy and countryish. There are some carryovers from perhaps blues music, because there's call and response between the voice and the fiddle and the steel guitar in the A sections. And one thing that makes it very clearly a country song is the way country musicians approach rhythm, is they approach it in a very rigid style. Country musicians tend to make a point of being very, very accurate and playing exactly on the beat. So the drums and the bass of a country song, when they're doing their rhythm section job, they play as dead on the beat as they can. Unlike in jazz music or rock music or funk music, where a lot of times the members of the rhythm section sort of play close to the beat, but a lot of times if a drummer wants to make the song sound a little bit faster, then he or she might decide they're going to push the beat or play on top of the beat, as they call it, and play just a little bit ahead of the beat, which makes the song sound a little bit more quick and up-tempo. Or if they want the song to sound laid back and relaxed, they'll play a little bit behind the beat. Country musicians, they play on the beat. And a lot of times the bass sits there going doom, 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 doom. And that's what the bass does. And it's got this very sort of heavy sound, and you'll hear that in Your Cheatin' Heart. So let me play this for y'all. Okay, so here we go. Starts with the pedal steel guitar.
Your cheating heart will make you weep. You'll cry and cry and try to sleep.
That's the first A. Here's the second A.
But sleep won't come the whole night through. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
And here's the B part.
When tears come down like falling rain, you'll toss around and call my name. You'll walk the floor.
Back to A.
The way I do. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
Steel guitar solo. And when it
go back through the A section, let's notice the call and response between
your
the voice and the fiddle response.
You'll find someday and crave the love you threw away.
And now the steel guitar will answer.
The time will come when you'll be blue. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
Section B.
When tears come down like falling rain, you'll toss around and call my name. You'll walk the floor the way I do. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
And in a couple minutes, we're going to look at how later country songs really sort of continue to branch out and stuff. But before we do, I want to take a minute to talk about bluegrass, which is sort of country music at its most traditional. It's a style that tends to not get concerned with, you know, the role of innovation or anything like that, or technology. There is no emphasis on steel guitar in bluegrass music. In fact, one thing about bluegrass music is it tends to feature acoustic instruments only. You won't find electric guitars in a bluegrass band. Bluegrass bands don't even usually like to have a drummer or anything, but they like acoustic instruments like acoustic guitars and banjos, fiddles, mandolins, stand-up basses. And one way in which bluegrass music actually shares something with jazz music since the time of bop especially is it's a style that emphasizes instrumental virtuosity. Bluegrass musicians tend to really pour their heart and soul into being able to play their instruments as fast and as proficiently as possible. And of course, another trait of bluegrass music is that it puts a premium on vocal harmony, on a style that's called the high lonesome style, that very high kind of nasal harmony we hear in a lot of bluegrass music. If I was looking for somebody to represent this style nicely, I'd probably go with Bill Monroe and his Bluegrass Boys. And this is Bill Monroe doing a song called Shady Grove, where you can hear all of these things front and center.
Shade of my little bee, shade of my darling, shade of my little piece of romantic heart.
That's the high lonesome style. And listen to how fast he's picking on the mandolin. Very virtuosic, very flashy.
Coffee girls on that old tree, loaded with brandy, rocking local with a woman, a girl with friends and candy. Hey, oh, my little bee, shake, oh, my darling. Hey, oh, my little bee, simple magic heart.
We really hear sort of the essence of the bluegrass style when we hear something like that. And you can see all those things that I've mentioned are kind of front and center. You know, the instruments are all acoustic. The banjo player and the mandolin player are really sort of going for it, really playing very, very impressively and very flashy. And then there's that nice, you know, pungent, high lonesome vocal style that we associate with bluegrass music as well. Okay, let's continue on now looking at how country songs develop through the 1950s and 60s. Let's look at a female country artist. This is a Patsy Cline song from 1961 called I Fall to Pieces. And I'm not going to say a lot about it, I'm just going to play it for you in a second, but you know, you can notice when you hear it that it has some things that are very, very identifiable as country music, such as the use of the pedal steel guitar right off. That's the first sound we hear. And if you look at the structure of the song, it's in a four-part structure. It's not AABA, like we'd have with, you know, a Tin Pan Alley song or a Duke Ellington song or something, but it's AABC, which is still that four-part design that's inherited from the era of songwriting in the early 20th century. And her vocal style is worth noting, too, because her vocal style is not a twangy country vocal style at all. It's a very soulful, almost jazz-like vocal style she sings in that blends real nicely into this country music instrumentation of pedal steel guitar, but there's sort of a nice jazzy sophisticated sheen that goes through the song. So let's give a listen to some of it. Okay, so that's lovely. And moving on into some 1960s country artists, I don't think I'd be doing myself justice if we didn't talk about this guy, the legendary Man in Black, Johnny Cash. And you know, the Johnny Cash song I want to look at is quite possibly his most famous song, a song called Folsom Prison Blues, a song which, you know, as the title would imply, is written in blues form, in the 12-bar blues form. Actually, he only uses 11 of them, but it's that same way of regulating harmony that we find in 12-bar blues. He does his lyrics differently. He doesn't arrange them as AAB lyrics like Robert Johnson or as refrain blues lyrics. He just writes different verses over each 12-bar progression. And you can hear the song, and you can hear the influence of the blues, obviously. Subject matter is bluesy. But you can also hear the country style, especially with the rhythm section playing that very, very rigid beat that we expect from a country rhythm section. And, of course, the other thing about the song that makes it interesting is it's sort of an example of what leads to a genre some people call outlaw country, because the song has a very anti-hero character in the song, a person who shot a man in Reno just to watch him die, as he says. So let's hear a little Folsom Prison Blues. This is actually recorded live at Folsom Prison in 1968.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on. But that train keeps a-rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. Thank you.
And let's try something different yet again. This is a country song by Merle Haggard from 1969 called Okie from Muskogee. And it's a good example of the thing that we were actually talking about way, way back at the beginning of this, that country sort of, you know, tries to walk a line between rowdiness and respectability. And this is one of those country songs that really sort of emphasizes the respectability and stuff. It's written in 1969 at the height of the 60s of hippie culture, of Vietnam War protest, of free love, of people discovering drugs and things like that. And this song is a very conservative song in the sense that, you know, the character in the song, the Okie from Muskogee in the song, is basically sitting here espousing traditional values, telling us things like the good people in Muskogee don't smoke marijuana, that they are patriotic, they don't protest the war, things like that. So it's a good example of sort of how country music oftentimes does like to extol quote-unquote wholesome values. Let's give a listen to part of it.
We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. We don't take no trips on LSD. We don't burn no draft cards down on Main Street. We like living right, being free. And we don't make no party out of loving. We like holding hands and pitching woo. We don't let our hair grow long and shaggy like the hippies out in San Francisco do. And I'm proud to be an Okie from Muskogee, a place where even squares can have a ball. We still wave old glory down at the courthouse, and white lightning's still the biggest thrill of all. Hey, leather boots are still in style for manly footwear. Beads and Roman sandals won't be seen.
And actually, when we get to hear Okie from Muskogee coming sort of on the heels of Folsom Prison Blues, we get to see how those things that I led off the discussion with, the struggle in country music between the wholesome and the not so wholesome, is one of those very, very present themes running throughout the genre. So, you know, there are country songs where you're talking about how much you love your mama and how much you want to stay on the farm and work and go to church. And there are country songs where you're talking about the desire to, like, you know, go out drinking on Saturday night and raise Cain. Or, you know, to take a favorite line from one of my country songs that I've heard before. There are songs about I threw the car seat in the dumpster and headed for the border. So, anyway, I want to look at, or listen to really, a little bit of two other songs, and I'm not going to really say anything about them. I'm just going to play them both. One is Stand By Your Man by Tammy Wynette from 1968, and the other one is George Jones, He Stopped Loving Her Today, from 1980. The reason I'm putting those two country songs on there is because they both sort of show the progression of country music and show sort of the type of music country music morphs into, and sort of remind us of what a long journey country has made from those early days of the Carter family and Jimmy Rogers recording in a hotel room for Ralph Peer in Bristol, Virginia, and show us how, you know, by the time we get to the late 60s and the 1980s and stuff, country has become a very big multi-produced, big production style of music. Also chose Stand By Your Man and He Stopped Loving Her Today because if you look at a lot of different polls, those are often cited as being the two greatest country songs of all time. So I'm going to let y'all listen to those, and then we'll come back and for a final thought.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman, giving all your love to just one man. You'll have bad times, and he'll have good times, doing things that you don't understand. But if you love him, you'll forgive him, even though he's hard to understand. And if you love him, I'll be proud of him, 'cause after all, he's just a man. When nights are cold and lonely, stand by your man and show the world you love him. Keep giving all the love you can. Stand by your man.
He said, I'll love you till I die. She told him, you'll forget in time. As the years went slowly by, she still preyed upon his mind. He kept her picture on his wall, went half crazy now and then, but he still loved her through it all, hoping she'd come back again. Kept some letters by his bed, dated 1962. He had underlined in red every single I love you. I went to see him just today. Oh, but I didn't see no tears. All dressed up to go away. First time I'd seen him smile in years. He stopped loving her today. They placed a wreath upon his door, and soon they'll carry him away. He stopped loving her today.
Okay. So this has been sort of a long video today. I realize that. But in its defense, a lot of it's just music, so you just have to listen to it. And you can hear the full versions of the songs that are included in here on the Spotify listening list, as well as some other songs that I didn't include. And we will talk about country music and its influence on popular music more later on, but today is really the only day we're going to devote to country music, because country music is certainly important, but the way I teach the class is more as a really history of rock music and rock styles of music. So when I'm teaching country, it's not that I don't like country or anything, it's just that for this particular class, I'm choosing to discuss how country has an influence on rock music, and that's certainly what's going to be apparent next time, because when we get back on our next session, we're going to talk about the beginnings of rock and roll proper in the 1950s. So I'll let y'all go for today, and when we reconvene, we're going to talk rock and roll. So get ready for some fun times. I'll see y'all next time. Bye-bye.